Hello, everyone. It is a pleasure to be with you today at Citus Con 2023. I wish we could have done this in person, but this is the next best thing. And hopefully, wherever you are, you're going to be able to enjoy this talk about artificial intelligence. This is one of my 59 talks related to Postgres, which you can see the URL for my slides, actually, and many other presentations at the URL there on the bottom right. It's also a QR code and a lot of recordings, actually, of me giving this talk. This talk is really interesting because, obviously, artificial intelligence is sort of a big topic these days, been kind of a hot topic for the past maybe 2-3 years as compute power has gotten better. But actually, the history of artificial intelligence goes down a lot farther. And I think we can learn some stuff by looking backward and also looking forward. And secondly, the goal of this talk is to talk about how Postgres can give you an ideal platform to use artificial intelligence in your applications. So I'm going to basically describe those two things in this talk. We're going to talk first about what artificial intelligence is. That's actually not a clear concept. But we'll go through some of the various theories as what it actually is. Then we're going to talk about machine learning and deep learning. You may have heard these terms before, but I have some diagrams to kind of explain exactly what goes on in a machine learning or deep learning process. And then section three, we're going to be showing you a demonstration using Postgres to solve a very trivial artificial intelligence problem. And finally, we'll finish up talking about sort of how to use hardware efficiency and software efficiency with artificial intelligence, why some of the tasks that are good for artificial intelligence, and particularly why is a database relevant and important for your artificial intelligence tool chain. So to get started, what is artificial intelligence? This is kind of a very fundamental question, not only in terms of computer science, but in terms of life in general and sort of the meaning of life, actually. In fact, the quote I got from Wikipedia is actually machines, artificial intelligence is machines that mimic cognitive functions associated with the human mind. So what does mimic mean? What does cognitive mean? That's kind of unclear. This is kind of a philosophical issue. I'm not going to go into it, but if you want to dig in, there's a URL here at the bottom to the Atlantic magazine. But what it basically says is that if the physical world only exists, then effectively there's nothing unique about human intelligence compared to machine intelligence, except that it's not naturally developed. And that's kind of an interesting distinction. So you're basically saying that humans are not really that different from computers because what we're thinking right now, what we're saying is really a process just like artificial intelligence is a process. But also, there's some philosophical issues that come in here. For example, free will becomes moot because you're only doing things that your human brain chemically decides to do. So anyway, I'm not going to get into that. But if you want to go down that rabbit hole, that's a good URL to start. As I said before, AI has been around for a long time. There was pre-computer philosophy related to AI. Which you know you may have heard of. Then there's also been robotics, where you had a machine that looked like a person was considered to be sort of artificial. The Turing test is a famous test for determining if something is intelligent or not. It's somewhat controversial, but it's sort of a standard that people work on. Expert systems really big in the 80s. As a way of harnessing computer power to solve complex problems. They kind of fell out of favor, and you have what is termed AI winter pretty much from the 1990s into the 2000s, where there really wasn't much, it really wasn't a whole lot of advancement in artificial intelligence. We have already seen a lot more recently. Obviously, Cirrus was the big one, and then, things like you know, being able to talk to your computer, right, and give it answers and so forth. ChatGPT is the big thing, you know, the past couple months. So I've always think it's like fusion energy. It's always 10 years away, but it's getting there. But I don't know. It's if you take a look at the article on the bottom, it kind of goes into it. But it is a very controversial topic, and it's hard to know really what the future is going to bring. But we are seeing a real resurgence this time of application of artificial of computer processing to problems that typically didn't fall within the traditional compute bound, you know, understanding of artificial intelligence. In fact, this is a great quote from somebody, I believe, at Microsoft. There you go, who basically says, you know, artificial intelligence in a way is a bad name, and basically. What he's saying is it's superimposing human skills on top of a computer, and that's really a wrong way to go. Again, nice Wall Street Journal article here at the bottom that goes into more detail. Another quote from this gentleman at Microsoft, basically saying that you know, it's you're basically using math. There's not really anything intelligent there. It just looks that way. Again, feel free to take a look at that if you want. So moving forward, I wanted to give some detail because there's a lot of sort of talk about artificial intelligence and, you know, sort of dog and pony shows about, oh, look, it can do this and, oh, it can talk to me or whatever. It can answer a question. But what really is it and what is it really doing? And because if we can't understand that, I can't actually show you how you can use Postgres to do it or you know, a computational case to do it. So there's basically different scales of artificial intelligence. There's actually a three-hour video here linked at the bottom, which I think is really helpful if you want sort of a lecture, I think, out of MIT about artificial intelligence. And I think it was a good sort of survey of sort of the span of what artificial intelligence is. So there's artificial intelligence, and inside of that, there's machine learning, which is what I'm going to be talking about today. And then even inside of that is called deep learning, which is even more complicated. And I'll kind of touch on that a little bit. But again, there's these hierarchies of what artificial intelligence basically is. And most of the activity in the past 5 years has been in this machine learning, deep learning area. There are other areas, but again, this is the one that most people are focused on now. This one is a hard, kind of a hard slide. I want to kind of go through it slowly and explain some of the terms. These are standard artificial intelligence terms that those people in the field recognize, but I'm going to just kind of explain what they mean. So we basically have three states here. So we have three points in time, right? The top point is the initial state. That's how the artificial intelligence starts. The machine learning starts. The second one is what we call training data or the training phase. And then the third is actually the operational phase. Okay, so at the top phase, the initial phase, we have something called a tensor. And a tensor is basically some measurement that we do to the inbound data. And inside that tensor is something called a neuron. And the neuron is effectively the measurement of how much that inbound data meets the criteria we're measuring, just to give you a very broad outline of what's going on. Now, these are terms that unfortunately are related to the human brain. I don't think they're super accurate, and some people in the artificial intelligence field feel that they're probably not a good use of terms, but these are the terms we have, so we're going to use them. Okay, so there's a tensor, which is the container, and then the neuron is whatever measurement we have. In the second phase, you can see there's weights that we actually use to determine how important each tensor is in our criteria. And then finally, obviously at the bottom, we're actually operational. You can see there's different levels of blue here the result phase here, the operational phase, indicating how important that tensor is to the final outcome of the actual thing we're trying to predict. Okay. There is also something, there's kind of several stages of machine learning, and I'm going to go through the three of them here because these are pretty fundamental to what we're talking about. So in unsupervised machine learning, you basically have an initial state and you pump a bunch of training data into the tensors. And you can see that being outlined right here. Okay. And then you get your, and that, and you just keep pumping data in, but there's no results. And this is kind of a weird case. You don't see a whole lot of unsupervised machine learning, but if you're trying to distinguish between two things and you don't really want to have results, you just want the system to figure out that there's two different things and predict, this is an example of that. But I don't see it a whole lot. I have a URL here at the bottom about unsupervised and reinforcement if you're curious. The second one is called supervised machine learning. This is one that you do you see the most, and this is one we're going to show you an example of, where we actually feed the data in, but we feed it in with the results that we expect. So this is training data. We're putting it in, and we're giving accurate results coming out, and then we can run our application and basically get our results. Actually, I think the example that I'll show you later might be unsupervised machine learning. The last one is called reinforcement. This is tricky. There's a lot of documentation about it. What it effectively does is once you enter the operational phase, you have sometimes the results feeding back into this tensors. So instead of having an initial stage, a training stage, and an operational phase, we actually, during the operational phase, we're feeding results back to improve the behavior of the artificial intelligence. And so that's sort of a learning case where you're continually learning instead of being at one stage and then not changing your tensors or your neurons the whole time. Okay. This one is, again, nice URL here at the bottom. This is deep learning. This is where you take a number of machine learning phases and you join them together. So you see this a lot, for example, with image processing. You see it with voice recognition, where some part of the phase would deal with volume and one with pitch and then with one with words and one with meaning and so forth. And you have this phases going through, and you see this a lot. Very computationally heavy. There can be millions of these things because you're multiplying them as you add each stage. So that's kind of the fundamental start. Let's look at a demonstration. And what the demonstration we're going to have is the question of whether an input number has a zero in it. So in this example, the first bullet has a zero in the tens position. The second number does not have a zero in the tens position. Okay. And we're going to try and set up an artificial intelligence system that effectively can predict, given a number, whether it has a zero or not. Yes, this is a silly example, but it's easy and it's easy to explain. So how we're going to do it, we're going to use something called PLPerl. It's a stored procedure language. You load it into Postgres and you're running Perl on Postgres. That's great. If you want to run the queries you're going to see, the URL here, right here in blue, you can actually download the SQL and run it yourself and practice and try it yourself, see how you do. So what we basically do is in PLPerl, we create a function that creates a tensor. Remember, that was the little box that we had. So we create a tensor of how many digits are in and also a tensor of whether the number is divisible by zero. So those are our kind of tensors that we have. We have actually 11 tensors, 1 to 10 for how many digits are in the number, and then 11th one, whether the number is divisible by zero. And it basically has true or false outcome from that, right? So we populate it with some queries, random data. We're running, I guess, it looks like 10,000 numbers in. And we're loading it into a training set, where that's our training set, which effectively tells us for each slot whether there's a zero in the slot, or basically what, you know, how that number goes. For example, you can see there's some zeros and there's some non-zeros. We have a weight computation, which tries to weigh the different tensors. So you figure out which tensors are most important or which neurons are most important across your artificial intelligence setup. Pretty big PLPerl function. We have something called a tensor mask, which basically masks out some things. This is computes the weight of the tensors of the neurons with something called softmax, so nothing goes over 100%. And then we basically store the weights. So we're basically taking our training set and we're loading it into the system so we can get the weights for the various tensors. Okay. And these are our results, which effectively are the probability given how many digits are in the number of whether it's a zero or not, whether it's a zero in the number or not. Okay. And we're gonna test it. So if you put 100 in, it's pretty bad predicting 100. So it says there's a 22% chance it has a zero in it, which I guess is okay because it's 100. But if I run 101, it thinks it's 11% chance. But obviously there is a zero in both of them. So in both cases, the 100 and the 101, it's guessing there's no zero when in fact there is. So not great. Here's another number, this very long number, and it says there's a 68% chance that there's a zero in there, and there isn't, right? So again, it's not great, but if you run it enough, and I'm going to do this right now with 1,000 numbers, just kind of run it through there, and I'm going to use basically some common table expressions to compute some analysis of our queries. You can basically see that given 10,000 numbers, it's pretty close. It's like 72% accurate, right? So this is not great, but it's probably okay. And that's kind of, that's probably most artificial intelligence would be much better than this. But the reason I'm showing this to you so you can see kind of what the process is of creating your tensors and neurons, loading the data in, loading the training data in, right? And then finally, basically getting your results. And that's kind of how you would do it. Now, this is not something you use in production, but you get the idea. Okay. Let's talk about practical things. How would you do this with Postgres, for example, now? You can do artificial intelligence in two places. You can do it client side, which would be something like MATLAB, Scikit, TensorFlow, or Weka, which are all client-side applications. Most of them are using Python now. But also you can do it server-side. So you can do server-side PLPython, just like we have PLPerl, we have PLPython. You can do MATLAB inside of PLPython. So you're now running your AI in the database itself. Now you may want to do the training outside, maybe just load the results in, right? That's a possibility. And also Scikit and all these URLs here basically give you some blogs or some videos about what people have actually done with AI with Postgres. Another case where you can have some performance benefit is with GPUs. You may have heard of the importance of GPUs for artificial intelligence. And the reason for that is something I talked about earlier, that when you're doing deep learning, you can have millions of these interactions for a single request because it's going to have to go through a whole bunch and then can potentially go through a whole bunch more. And every tensor like connects to every other one. So it becomes this very complicated, computationally heavy case. Because tensors can have millions of neurons. So one of the values of GPUs is that you can do parallel processing. So Postgres does have the ability to use GPUs using special clients server-side languages that allow you to kind of harness the power of GPUs to do AI. And I know some people are doing that in the database. Let's talk a little bit about tasks. What things are AI particularly good for? Obviously, when I was a kid, the big one was chess, because chess was considered to be sort of the big challenge for intelligence. So obviously, if a computer could do real well in chess, that was a great thing. I think chess, with Deep Blue and a lot of other examples, chess, computers in chess have really kind of taken the game. It's really hard to beat a computer at this point. I know there are chess grandmasters that are pretty good, very, very good. But again, it is sort of an old challenge to AI. Jeopardy was done with Deep Blue. That was kind of an interesting AI example years ago. Voice recognition is something we use pretty much all the time with our phones, with home automation devices, where we're talking, saying, Alexa, do something, or Google Voice, do something. Search, that's also part of ChatGPT, obviously the new one. Recommendation engines are using it. Image detection to detect things in images. Again, there's some videos about how to, and weather forecasting, that's been around for a long time. The use of weather forecasting for using AI has been just long time and actually very, very powerful. This is a great one, I think. How do you do fraud detection, right? How do you detect if there's a fraudulent charge in, at a store or something? What things would you measure, right, for that? And the URL here at the bottom gives the example, but basically you have to think, what would be my tensors? What would I measure? Would I measure the charge amount for fraud? Would I measure if it was a swipe or a chip or a PIN, the vendor distance, the vendor country, previous charges? And what they do is they basically load a lot of these things into an AI engine. They feed a bunch of valid transactions in, and they feed a bunch of fraudulent transactions in, and the system automatically measures how important are each of these things in the result that I'm getting, right? And you basically get an answer, and that's exactly what happens is you get, you sort of get that answer from the system that tells you how accurate it is, okay? Fraud detection steps. So how would you do it? You choose an attribute for fraud, whatever they would be. You load a bunch of data in, you feed the data in, you start feeding the data in, then you feed correct, and then you may actually continue to feed fraudulent transactions, the good transactions, back in the system, so that you continually get new output telling you what's accurate and what's not, right? So why use a database? Why use a database in all of this? One of the reasons is because machine learning requires a lot of data, as we've talked about already, and most of your data is probably already in your database, so it kind of makes sense to have the data near where have the machine learning where your data is, right? You could use it for previous training data. It has seamless integration to all of the data you have. You can take immediate action. For example, you can check the AI to see whether a transaction is likely fraudulent before you commit the transaction. Now, you can do it externally, but doing it in the database has a lot of advantages. Obviously in the database, it's all one system. All the transactions are concurrent, backups, everything is one system. And also Postgres does great things like GIS, full text search, complex data types, and indexing, which you can also use in your learning, in your tensors to try to figure out what type of data, how far is the person. The system already has that. So again, I think that's really, kind of useful. So again, user applications using that, using artificial intelligence in the database. I've already covered that. There are some performance issues like the optimizer plans and the database settings and resource usage. You could also use that for AI. So for example, you could have the optimizer say, oh, this plan should be this other way because the AI says that it would be better. Or database settings, maybe you could run data into AI, or you can use it for alerting to malicious activity. So there's a bunch of areas in the database itself that can be used for AI, and then obviously a lot of application use that can be used for AI. And I think that's also something we're going to be seeing a lot in the future. So again, that does finish my talk. I hope that was interesting to you. But effectively, what we wanted to talk about was AI, what Postgres is doing there, how you can use Postgres to effectively work with AI. And I'm going to leave you with this slide here at the bottom. There's some reasons I chose that image, and you feel free to sort of wonder why I did. That's actually a real picture of a building in Phoenix. So again, is it real? Is it fake? Is it AI? We don't know. And I want to thank you for allowing me to speak to you today. It's been an honor and a privilege to be talking to you. And I hope to see you perhaps at a real conference sometime. So thank you very much. I hope you have a great rest of the day.